My name is Camille Goldstone Henry, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of Xylo Systems. Xylo Systems is a tech platform for businesses to measure and manage their biodiversity footprint. The purpose of Xylo Systems is to regenerate biodiversity globally. We've seen a lot of biodiversity loss, so we're empowering businesses that have an impact on the environment to start regenerating our ecosystems for future generations. I have worked with endangered species around the world and have to deal with a lot of biodiversity data and found it really hard in my career to draw out quick insights, and it took a really long time to aggregate that information, meaning it would take us years to make decisions to save critically endangered species. If businesses don't have access to that type of information fast enough, then we're not going to save our species in time and we're going to see biodiversity loss increase dramatically. Prior to starting at the Australian Graduate School of Management, I was very much an introverted scientist. I had no idea about business, but I knew I wanted to be a business leader and use business to make a difference when it comes to biodiversity. I got so much out of AGSM. I really became a confident businesswoman and was able to start my own company. I started my company Xylo Systems about halfway through my MBA, and that allowed me to tailor all of my subjects specific to the business challenges I was experiencing at the time. We heavily use artificial intelligence, and I was able to select AI and advanced analytics subjects to understand what they were and implement those as a technology solution in our business. AGSM MBA is more than just a degree. It helped connect me to a network of peers that will be Australia's future business leaders.
Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to Meet the CEO. My name is Chris Stiles. I have the great privilege of being Dean of UNSW Business School. Tonight, I'd like to warmly welcome you alumni, friends, and special guests to what promises to be another excellent Meet the CEO. I begin this evening by acknowledging the Gadigal people, the traditional owners of the lands where we are meeting tonight, and all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander elders past and present, and their communities who've shared and practiced their teachings over thousands of years. We recognise Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people's ongoing leadership and contributions, including to business, education and industry. UNSW Business School has many reasons to celebrate this year. Firstly, we're thrilled to celebrate the 20th year of Meet the CEO, an event that's been running continuously since 2003. This event has been instrumental in connecting our alumni with some of the most accomplished and influential leaders in business and government, and that will continue this evening. It's been a platform for invaluable insights, knowledge sharing, and networking opportunities. And the feedback we receive is that it continues to be a source of learning for everyone who attends. Secondly, it's also the 20th anniversary of the UNSW Business School's Alumni Leader Network. This network is made up of over 200 business school graduates who have emerged as leaders and innovators in their respective fields. These remarkable individuals have made a lasting impact, and their dedication to our school is truly inspiring. They remain an active part of our community, generously giving their time to support and strengthen our network of students and alumni. We extend our heartfelt appreciation to each one of them for their continuous service and contribution to UNSW Business School. In addition to these milestones, I'm compelled and very proud to announce that for the second consecutive year, UNSW Business School has been ranked the number one business school in Australia by AFR Boss, clearly the most accurate and rigorous ranking there is globally, which I think I said last year. Now, what is great about this ranking is not just being number one, although that's pretty good, it's that it's a wonderful reflection of our incredible community. That's because these rankings evaluate nearly 40 Australian business schools across three key categories: quality, reputation, and career impact. And that means that our community has to be excellent at not just one thing, but excellent across a broad range of activities that cover our research, education, and societal impact missions. Therefore, this result is something the whole business school community should be very proud of, as it reflects the commitment and quality of our students, the dedication of staff, the advocacy of an engaged alumni community, and the outcomes for industry and government with whom we partner in research and graduate employment. At this point, I was going to say congratulations to you all and give yourselves a round of applause, but why not do it again? Meet the CEO is an important part of what we do and stand for. It's UNSW Business School's premier leadership series, offering ongoing learning and access to contemporary thinking in business and government. And it reaffirms our commitment to making an ongoing difference by providing lifelong learning to our community, as no matter how advanced or successful one is, there is always a new challenge or opportunity around the corner. This is why we're so grateful to our guest speakers who are willing to share their leadership journey with us. Our special guest this evening is a UNSW alum, as well as one of our UNSW Business School alumni leaders, Alexis George, CEO of AMP. Alexis will be interviewed by Ellen Derrick, Managing Partner of Consulting Deloitte Australia, also one of our UNSW Business School alumni leaders and a member of our Business Advisory Council. Thank you to all of those who've sent in questions for Alexis. We had an overwhelming response, over 300 questions, which is a new record. So this could be a long night. But we will do our best to cover as many as we can during the conversation, and there'll also be a Q&A afterwards. You can also share your thoughts and comments and experience about today's event on Facebook and LinkedIn using the hashtag MeetTheCEO. I note also that we're live streaming and recording this interview tonight. The video will be available within the next couple of days on the UNSW Business School website, and we encourage you to share the link with your friends and colleagues who may benefit from the insights we gain tonight. And I've just been told that if that isn't enough, you might have noticed a large cruise ship just outside. It will be sounding its horn sometime during the interview. No doubt in appreciation of a particularly profound insight from Alexis at the time. They could have submitted a question like everybody else, but we'll look forward to that. It's now my great pleasure to welcome UNSW Chancellor, Mr. David Gonski AC, to introduce our guest speakers. Thank you, David.
Thank you, Chris. Ladies and gentlemen, firstly, may I add my welcome to Chris's. It's wonderful that you're here tonight, and we welcome each and every one of you. If I can also acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which this wonderful gallery stands. Ladies and gentlemen, over the last 18 years, I don't think I've missed a Meet the CEO. During that time, we've been told where the toilets are, we've been told where the fire escape is, but never before have we been warned that there's going to be a horn from the Coral Princess. And I just want you to, you might say this is not of great moment, but it is, because it indicates the level of detail that our dean goes to in preparing these things. He's been down there listening to it, testing that we'll hear it, and we're very grateful, Chris, for all the effort you put in. I should also add, I warned him last year that when you say I'm number one, there is a little bit of a risk, because you're either going to be number one next year, but you could also be number two. And he, of course, overdid that by making sure he was number one again, and we congratulate him. Ladies and gentlemen, I love Meet the CEO. It fits in beautifully into this continuing education situation that we want at our university. It brings you together. We always get a top-class person to be interviewed and a top-class person to interview them. This is essentially what the outreach program should be and is of our business school and, if I may say so, of our university. But you didn't come to hear me. Let me now tell you a little bit about the people who you're going to see up here in a minute. And if, by the way, I describe somebody you're not expecting there, you can leave before the boat toots. This evening, we're very privileged, as Chris said, to have a UNSW alumni who is the CEO of AMP, Alexis George. Now, Alexis was appointed as CEO of AMP in August 2021. That followed 25 years of experience in financial services in our industry in Australia. She spent 7 years at the ANZ, leaving there as high up as Deputy CEO. Prior to ANZ, she spent 10 years with ING in a number of senior roles. These included, and listen to this, CEO of the Czech Republic and Slovakia. I didn't even know where that was, but I looked it up and she did a wonderful job. I have no doubts there. Alexis holds a Bachelor of Commerce, that's why she's an alumna, from our business school. She's a member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants and a graduate of the Australian Institute of Company Directors. She's also an active member of the Chief Executive Women and is a passionate advocate for women in leadership roles. She has a CV as long as your arm, but I do want to say I'm a bit disappointed in her. And I apologize, Alexis, I have to be honest as Chancellor. I read her CV twice, and nowhere does she mention what happened in Wagga 5 years ago. In Wagga 5 years ago, the ANZ board, which I chaired, and she was deputy CEO, met, and our planes were canceled due to a massive storm on the eastern side of Australia. Immediately, Alexis said, I'm deputy CEO, I will drive the chairman back to Sydney, a 5.5 hour trip. And I wish to report to all of you, in doing that, despite the fact that hail developed, a wind came up, the road got blocked, she showed leadership, competence, great driving ability, fantastic concentration, and if I may say so, as she never stopped talking throughout, great intelligence. Alexis is a wonderful person. And I want to tell you also that Ellen Derrick, who will be interviewing her, is also an alumni, and we're very proud of her too. She is managing partner of consulting for Deloitte Australia and a member of Deloitte's national executive. Prior to this appointment, she was the national leader, public sector and public policy at Deloitte's, and she's had more than 20 years experience consulting, and she specialised in work with government to achieve strategic policy outcomes. But Ellen is much broader than just the work she does through Deloitte's. She's chair of BATIA, a for-purpose preventative mental health organisation, and she's also a member of Corporate Mental Health Alliance of Australia. Ladies and gentlemen, it's wonderful to have two alumni battling it out tonight. And could I please ask Alexis and Ellen to come up to the stage?
Passed the first test.
Yeah, well done. that was a real test too. Thanks so much, David. Very warm introduction. And welcome, everyone in the room and everyone joining us virtually as well. I feel very privileged to be invited to lead the Meet the CEO discussion tonight. And thanks, Alexis, for being here. Now that I know that you survived that drive from Wagga and everything that entailed, and I don't even know.
I did have a bit of direction from the back seat, I'm just saying.
I now feel much more confident that we're going to be able to deal with the horn. Okay? I was unsure, now. I feel pretty good about it. Our challenge is to make sure we've hit the crescendo when it goes, so let's see how we go. Everyone, there will be a chance for questions. We'll get there. 300 submitted, you know, quite phenomenal. But I have the mic, so I'm going to get us started. And I'm going to take you back, right? I want to hear, you know, get in terms of your formative experience, early life experience, take us through that.
Right? Yes. So I was born in Bega. I don't know if anyone knows Bega. I know one person in this room does, because we both graduated from Bega High, no mean feat. If you know about Bega, it's a very small country town, about 4,000 people. I always say half the town was my relatives and the other half the town was married to my relatives. So there was no hiding. In fact, the house I grew up in is the house my parents died in, so nothing changed in my life until I went to high school. My mother was number 10 out of 11. And my dad was a 10-pound pom. So, we always had food and stuff on the table. We didn't have a lot of money. I didn't realise that till I was about 17. Yeah. But my mother always used to say from birth. You will go to university, you will go to university, you will go to university. And so I went to university. Because you, so, never deny your mother.
Yeah, no, absolutely right, except for my kids. But what led you to University of New South Wales? And take us through that a little bit and that experience at the time.
Yeah, it's funny. As you said, I've got a long CV because I'm old. But, but, you know, there's a time when you're at high school that you have to go to the counsellor's office to tell them what you want to be when you grow up. I'm sure some people remember that experience. And I always wanted to be a doctor or a vet or something like that. But, you know, reality struck. I came from a small town. I was going to have to move to the city. I wanted to go to university, and I know I've heard people talk about the difficulty of that. And so I actually had to be practical. Mm. And I remember sitting outside the counsellor's office going, well, I'm good at maths, I'm good at economics. And then I saw something in one of those books that said, you can work at Deloitte, interestingly, and go to part-time university, work full-time, and then you'll get free education at the end of that. And I thought, that sounds like a good idea. I'll apply for that.
Yeah. So you were going to university, you were working at Deloitte. Pleased to see we have that in common. Coming up.
I was 17 when I was working at Deloitte. I did not know what I was doing.
But that early experience in growing up in Bega, you're at university, you're working at Deloitte. What were you confronted with that?
Well, to say I was naive would be the understatement of the... I mean, I grew up in a small town. I never did anything wrong. I was a goody two-shoes. If the whole town knows who you are, you have no choice about that, right? Although my brother would beg to differ. But anyway, so I suppose the first thing for me was coming to Deloitte, and it was a long time ago. There were two of us in the cohort of this graduates, and it was the first public schoolgirls that ever had at Deloitte. So that was really interesting because we were unique.
Yeah.
They're like these beasts they'd never understood. So that was really interesting for me. But I think the second thing, my first boyfriend, who was also at Deloitte...
we'll get off that theme. Yeah. Keep going.
He went to Riverview High School for his high school. And I remember one day he's like, come and visit my school. I'm like, visit a school? Why would I want to visit your school? And he said, no, come and have a look at the Rose Garden. And I remember we were driving through the school. I did not understand that there were schools other than Bega High School. Our whole school would have fit on the first oval. And honestly, it was actually quite confronting, that first experience.
So tell us then, you know, your early career and some of those moments, like the seminal moments in your career that you look back on now, like some of the more pivotal moments. You moved on from Deloitte, we can move on from that.
Yeah.
Take us through some of the more pivotal moments after that.
Well, I think there's a couple. And actually, the first one was at New South Wales Uni. I'm not just saying that because we're at an event. But I won quite a few prizes at the university for accounting, actually. And I know that's funny, because I'm such a bad accountant nowadays. But as part of that, I actually realised I was reasonably smart, and I probably didn't know if I was or wasn't. But more importantly than that, and sorry Deloitte, but I got to meet quite a few PwC partners because they donated the prizes to the university. I'm sure Deloitte donates
We've
the prizes
smarter.
Today.
Yep.
Yeah. But PwC donated those prizes. So then they said, why don't you come work for us once you've finished university? And I was pretty young and impressionable, and they courted me and took me to dinner and all that. And so I went and worked with them. But it was an amazing experience for me because I got to do so many different things with them. I got to do training, so I got to communicate better. I was in audit. I got to live in London with them for quite a few years and do consulting. So a very amazing experience for me across a broad spectrum of things, which I'm very appreciative of.
Yeah. And you could have continued to do that though. Right?
Yeah.
You were, bright spark on path to partner, and you said no. Why?
Yeah, I loved that work, and I was in London, and I really did enjoy what I was doing. But I went to work one day, and someone said, can you come and speak to me, please? And I went in, and they said, you're now on the partner program, which I'm not sure what it's like there, but you knew you would be observed quite heavily for the next year and a half. In order to be appointed for a partner. And until that point, I hadn't really thought about my career. Woo!
Very well handled, yep.
There's usually more having, knowing that.
I was gonna say, yeah, there will be more.
No, so I hadn't really thought about my career. Like, people just said, do you wanna do this? Yeah, I'll have a go at that. Do you wanna do this? Yeah, I'll have a go at that. But I went home that night and I thought to myself, I actually don't want to be a partner. And so I went back to PwC the next day and I resigned and said, sorry, I don't want to be a partner. I'm just going to go bumming around the world for the next year, which I did.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, I just, much as I respect people who do want to be partners, I just wanted to be somewhere where I could have a direct influence rather than an indirect influence.
Yeah, absolutely. And so that led you more directly into financial services, right?
Yeah.
Like, what were some of the pivotal roles, moments, you know, really on the path to now CEO? What were the most important things?
Yeah. I would love to say it was all very organized and I thought about it. And I love it when young people said, tell me about your career path. And like, a lot of it's luck. But I really was backpacking around South America for 9 or 10 months. And I came back to Australia and I had no job, I had nowhere to live, and I had minus $2,000 on my credit card. And so that was in the middle of a bit of a downturn in Australia. And so it wasn't like I thought, I want to work in this particular industry, to be honest.
Yeah.
BT at the time, who was a very big fund manager and very successful fund manager, was one of the only places hiring. And so that's how I got a job. And that's how I got into financial services.
Very good.
I never regret it since.
No, though. Absolutely. Nor should you. But how did you think about that job at the time, right? How did you approach it?
Well, it's interesting because I had this, and some people have heard this story, I tell it often, but I had this glorified title of portfolio accountant. Actually, I was a bank reconciliation clerk.
Good.
And there's nothing wrong with being a bank reconciliation clerk. But I remember I was so upset, and I'd started with this other woman. We're both bank reconciliation clerks. And she'd had a similar career to me. And I was so upset because I'm thinking, I could have been a partner at PwC, and here I am reconciling bank accounts. And that was... I suppose I let ego get. And she gave me one of the best pieces of advice, and I try to live by this all the time. She said, you have two choices here, Alexis. You can be the best damn reconciliations clerk you can be, or you better get out of here quick smart. And I really try to live like be the best I can at what I'm doing all the time, because I think it's really important. You can destroy your own personal brand if you don't.
Absolutely. Best way to have impact, best way to get ahead too,
right?
So, I mean, it worked out, right?
Yeah.
That strategy.
Okay.
So, you did all right. So if you're giving advice now, right? And we have, you know, lots of graduates, you know, in on those questions, you know, it was around what advice would you give to new graduates early in career? Like, how has that impacted the advice you give?
Yeah, look, I think there's a couple of things. I think being the best you can be every day is really important.
Now that was appropriate.
Really important.
Yes, that well timed.
You know, and some days we're not all 100% for there's things going on in our lives, but I think that's really important. I think the other thing is really being curious about everything. Mm. I am a mad podcast listener, and I think you can learn in so many different ways now, and I find that amazing. You know, it doesn't have to be a textbook, you can listen to things, but I think constantly learning is important. And I think the other thing is, you know, you really need people who believe in you and support you. And when you're, you know, when you're really thinking, maybe I can't do this, we'll push you forward and encourage you to have a go. And I think we all think we can do it by ourselves, but we can't. Mm. We need to have people around us who support us, give us help, advice. Don't have to always take it, but at least listen. And I think that's really important. And it's not just, today's world's not about the upward trajectory. It's about adding new things to your kit bag all the time. And I always say to people, if the job you're taking doesn't make you feel a little bit sick in the stomach, don't take it. Because it's not
spot on. Great advice. I always say that too. Like opportunities don't show up as joy, right? They show up as challenge, right? Yeah. And leaps of faith a lot of times. But you know, your journey, it's really, I feel like, you know, we have these conversations, rear view kind of, you know, vision, and it sounds easy. Right, a journey like that, a path to CEO, it almost sounds easy. Now, we know it wasn't. Like, what were some of the moments that were truly challenging?
Truly challenging. I think one of the most challenging experiences for me was moving to Prague and being the CEO of Czech Republic and Slovakia for ING. I probably didn't think that through enough. I moved my two kids, my husband and my two dogs. We all went to Prague. And the reason why I say that, they'd never seen anyone as a CEO there, because I did work for ING, except for very tall Dutch people. Men, actually.
Yeah.
And when they heard that there was a woman coming from Australia, I think they thought someone from Mars was coming, actually. And they probably thought that even more after my first 2 weeks there. But what did I learn from that? Like, I walked into that experience, you know, I was reasonably senior manager, but I had never worked in a culture so completely different to Australia, completely different, where I didn't speak the language and not many people spoke English. And I remember going to the very first meeting with the management team, and I just plonked myself down at the table, as we do in Australia, and I thought I did a fantastic speech about what they could expect from me and what I expected from them and what we were going to aim for. I went back to my office, which honestly was about the size of this room, sat in there. And the HR manager, and I'll be eternally grateful to her, came in to me about 5 minutes later, and she said, "They think you're a weak leader." And I was like, "They don't even know me." Like, I've just made one speech. And she said, "You did not sit at the head of the table. And in this country, sitting at the head of the table is really important to demonstrate your strength." And I tell that, I know it's a silly little story, but it really made me realize I can't always be exactly the way I want. I have to adapt to the circumstances that I'm in. And in Czech, that was really important to them that I sat in that spot. And so I sat in that spot every time after that. I mean, I think you've got to be your authentic self, but you've got to understand your surroundings and adapt to them as well. Yeah. And I really learned a lot from that experience.
Yeah, that's a great story. How important do you think international experience or, you know, multi-geography experience is, right, in forming and advancing in career?
Well, for me, I've been lucky enough to live in London, in Prague, and then in Hong Kong. Yeah. And I would say for me, it was very important. I don't think it has to be, but for me, it was very important to broaden my horizons, to understand adaptability. You know, I lived through the global financial crisis in Europe with ING, who almost went to ground at that point. And I learned so much from that experience of trying to manage through that period. So I think for me, really important, but it doesn't necessarily have to be.
Okay, very good. Now, if I had submitted a question, this is what it would be, right? Even though those are all mine. You're a deputy CEO at ANZ,
yeah.
Right? And you know, I believe very strongly in team leadership, not the hero CEO. I have a deputy. I'm often judged for having a deputy. I'm interested in how that worked. Like, how did it work for you? What was the dynamic, the interplay? How did it work?
It's very hard when you're sitting in front of David Gonski, because he was the chair of ANZ at that time. Firstly, I don't think anyone would say that Shane Elliott was a hero CEO at all. And I think our relationship, I hope he feels the same about this. When you're the CEO of something, you don't always get the truth. And with best intentions, people will frequently tell you what you want to hear as opposed to what you need to hear. And I feel that with Shane and I, firstly, he knew that I only ever had the best interests of ANZ at heart and of our people and our customers and of him being successful as well as the rest of us. So I would like to think I was the person that told him the things he needed to know as opposed to what everyone wanted him to know. Yep. And I think he would say I was very honest in that respect. And, you know, we had different strengths. Mm. Shane was very cerebral. He's always reading books. Me too, by the way. I read lots of books.
Yes.
No, but he's very cerebral. Yep. He studies history a lot, whereas I think I'm far more pragmatic and like, great idea, Shane, but that ain't going to work.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And, you know, spent a lot of time working with the customers, etc. So I think we're a very good combination like that.
Yeah, fantastic. I do think, you know, the combination matters. But we talk a lot, you know, around, yeah, making sure you have, you know, a variety of voices around you. So, you know, I love that perspective. Thank you. I want to, let's talk today, AMP.
Yeah.
What are the big issues? What are the big opportunities? That's a long conversation. What are the big things facing AMP now?
Look, I think there's some wonderful things about the brand of AMP and some history that I think we have to deal with. It is one iconic brand, right? You can see it if you look out there. It's sitting on the building, and it's hard to imagine that brand not being on a building in Circular Quay if you've ever worked in business. So it's a really iconic brand. But it's been through a really tough time over the last 10 years. And I think restoring the brand and restoring what we stand for is a big challenge. We have dealt with many of the things of the past over the last years. We have a clear strategy about what we want to do and be going forward. But we sit in an environment today which is a pretty difficult environment, right? The world is very uncertain. We've got inflation, as we saw coming out today, so, you know, don't know what's happening with the interest rate environment. People are finding it tough, and our customers are finding it tough. So I think while we, you know, we're dealing with the past, we've got a strategy, you have to be nimble about what's happening, either economically or with technology, etc. So no challenges that other people aren't facing, but, you know, it's fun. Most of the time.
Yes, exactly. Most of the time. And, you know, yeah, a number of challenges in the environment, right?
Yeah.
One of the opportunities within that, of course, is emerging technology.
Yes.
Right? Advent, you know, mainstream AI, particularly Gen AI at the moment. How is that impacting your strategy, and what are you seeing as the big opportunities? I know you've written about this, you know, in terms of financial advice. You know, how are you seeing that, and how is AMP adapting?
Yeah, look, I've always been interested in that, and probably some of our team hate the fact that I've been listening to something and I come in and we've got to do this. But before the problems that we're having in the Middle East, I did have the opportunity to go and spend a week in Israel, which is now one of the technology kind of generation places, and spend a week talking about AI and cyber. And it really opened my eyes up to the changes that I think we're going to have to face into, not only as businesses, but as a society. And some will be for good, you know, and some probably won't be for good. But what I know is you've got to get on the train, because it doesn't matter. The train is taking off, whether you're on it or not, so we have to face into it. I think we've been playing around with a few things internally. We're just about to embark on a pitch it kind of campaign, because you need people who are interested, who are driven, who are trying to solve problems, because the one thing I learned, you've got to have a problem to solve or you'll spend a lot of money playing around in a sandpit. And so we're in that phase of really where are we going to double down now. But I mean, everyone's playing. We've got Copilot, like probably half the room here does, and we've been playing with that and teaching it to take minutes in our executive committee and asking it to to write emails. So I think you've got to be on this journey, quite honestly.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's great to, you know, like I say, you've spoken publicly about embracing that and broader opportunities for the industry, right, which has, you know, been fantastic. You'll be pleased to know you're not the only CEO who's, you know, kind of turns to the team and just says, do this.
Yes.
Working with lots of clients, like, do Gen AI. Yeah. But yeah, we must embrace it. Right?
Yeah, we have. Look, yeah. It's coming. It's here.
It's here.
Our people are using it. Our customers are using it. So we have to learn to use it for good.
Yeah. So challenging environment in a lot of different ways, right? You stepped into a challenge, you know, really turbulent environment. How has that changed your leadership style over time, if at all? In what ways?
I'd like to think not fundamentally, but I have learned that you do have to adapt, as I said before. I mean, when you're a CEO, you're being watched all the time to make sure that what comes out of your mouth is consistent with what you're doing and what you're and the way you're behaving. You know, I'm probably a naturally, you know, I like a laugh and I like sometimes to be silly. I really have learned to temper that somewhat. Because people are watching you, not to call you out, but they're watching to make sure you're consistent all the time. And I think that's one thing I've really, really learned, ensure you're consistent with what you're saying and doing. And then when you make mistakes, and we do, admit it for goodness sake.
Yeah.
And say, I'm not infallible, right? I am not the smartest person in the room. And I need help. So I've learned to ask for help openly from my network, from people in the organisation, from younger people who are digitally native and have a whole different perspective on things. So I think being consistent, asking for help when you need it, as some of the things I really learned. Before that, I probably thought, you got to do it all by yourself, etc. But it's not true.
Absolutely. I think, you know, we can scream that from the rooftops on asking for help and from a broad range, right, of stakeholders and perspectives. You know, you still, there are hard days. There's media, you know, your shareholders, take your pick. There are challenging days. When you're having your challenging day, what's your North Star, right? I believe in North Stars. What's the thing that really keeps you going?
Well, I mean, I genuinely, you heard about my background. I think that really grounds me. And for me, it's about, I know this sounds really trite, but I'd really like to leave the place a better place than when I started. That's what makes me go back to work the other day, seeing people develop and thrive and learn and progress is what makes me go every day. And then when I'm really having a bad day, just talking to customers. It's really nice. Getting out and talking to customers, not nice all the time, but mostly it's nice talking to customers. And, you know, we have a contact centre out at Parramatta, and when I am having a bad week, I will go and spend a couple of hours out there with them. They're the people that face into our customers every day, listen to what they're talking to. It re-energises you to carry on.
Yeah, wonderful. I don't think anything of that is trite. It's legacy, right? And yeah, phenomenal.
I think, for me anyway, you can't be a leader without people around you, and I really like to see people thrive.
Yeah, fantastic. Now, asking for a friend, would you recommend being a CEO?
I have to say yes, don't I? No, look, I reckon it. I think it is a fantastic job, right? You get to see and do things that you can never imagine you'd do. You get to set a strategy and watch it thrive or fail, and you learn from the failures. You get to help people grow and promote, and you see the impact you have on customers. I wasn't a CEO for a little while. I wasn't running a business. And Dave and I were just talking about this, but I got really bored and I really wanted to get back to being a leader again.
Very good. Now, we have a few things in common.
Yes.
I've come to learn. We've both got two kids, older daughter, younger son, two Labradors. We both have a passion for mental health.
Yes, we do.
And you volunteer for Lifeline.
Yeah,
tell us a bit about that and what does that bring to you?
Yeah, I've volunteered for Lifeline for about 9 years now, I think. And what does it bring to me? I had the, I suppose, misfortune, or I don't know if it was luck or misfortune, but unfortunately a young employee of ours suicided at work, and I had to deal with his parents and the police, etc. And I think we did everything to support him, but watching the impact it has on families and him really got me interested in mental health. I think it's an incredibly important thing, especially in business. And so I wanted to give something back. And so had just been interested in that topic, finally decided to go and volunteer for Lifeline and do that, you know, sit on the phones every other week. And I think for me, there's a couple of things. Firstly, I can do it because I'm able to compartmentalise, and not everyone can do that. But I realise every time there's a lot of people who don't have connections, who don't have family, who don't have that social network, and who just need someone to talk to. And if, you know, 4 hours of my life every fortnight helps someone like that to feel a little bit better,
that's
great. I feel better. And but I also feel genuinely grateful for my life. Mm. I go back, I'm financially secure, I have a lovely family, a nice group of friends, and it makes you feel very lucky.
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't know about you, but it gives me plenty of energy to do the other things as well.
Yes, absolutely.
Right? Yeah, absolutely. Wonderful. Now, we have a lot of emerging leaders, right, particularly online. If you were to give one piece of advice to emerging leaders, career advice on how to progress, what's most important, what would it be?
Well, firstly, I think being genuinely curious about what's happening and being constantly learning. I think that is incredibly important. The minute you stop that, you will stagnate. The second thing for me in this new world that we're all living in is now, don't become obsessed about the upward trajectory. I think just keep make sure you take risks, add skill sets to your kit bag. I think that's important. And you know, really in the modern world we live in, where there's information coming at you from every source all day, every day, I genuinely think making sure you are mentally healthy and resilient is a skill we absolutely have to have in this day and age. And I really, really try to stay half physically healthy, half. Glass of red wine helps. I was very pleased with myself today because I did 10 push-ups on my toes.
Well done. That is impressive. Well done.
No, but I think being really, making sure you keep yourself healthy mentally is really important, because it's a hard world to live in, CEO or any other way.
Absolutely. I think we all have our toolkits, right? One of mine and in my list is actually to manage the information flow. Right?
Yeah.
You know, that is part of it. Yeah, and certainly to...
I'm not very good at texts, I must admit.
good to know. Okay, I'm definitely getting the red flashes to move to questions. So there are mics available, and we have some questions online as well. So we might start here, and then I'll take a question from online as well.
Thank you very much. Of all the people who graduated from UNSW Business School, there would be perhaps, I don't know, 1% or 0.1% who become CEOs. On the other extreme, there would be a small proportion, small percentage of people who probably are unemployed. What are the fundamental physiological and psychological traits which separates these two groups? Thank you.
My goodness,
that was a better question.
That is a really big question. We've got lots of professors here. It's a very good question, because it's a fine line, right, between going one way and another. And I told you the background I came from, and I can assure you the town I came from was not a wealthy town. So I do think... I'm not an expert on this, so please give me a bit of leeway, but I do think my parents had a huge role to play in that, about the importance of education, the importance of hard work, and were very good role models, at least from the hard work perspective and pushing education. I think that is really important. But honestly, I think there is a bit of luck along the way as well. And I talked to you about some of the luck I'd had. I started working with BT. There was no planning in that. That was luck. And I worked hard, but I worked with people who believed in me and helped me. And I think I will always try to help people who ask for it, because I think that's incredibly important. But that is a big question, and I think probably requires much more attention in an answer. I don't know if you have a view.
Over to you. well played.
But thank you for that. I mean, it's a really hard question, and
it's
one
a
I think
really
about
hard question.
A lot. Because, I mean, my brother's a truck driver still in Bega, and I went to university, and we were brought up exactly the same. I don't know why we're so different.
Well, you know, from everything you've said and what I've learned about you too, like, you've given some nuggets of advice, right, tonight, and one of those is whatever opportunity is sitting in front of you, and it might not look like an opportunity, dive straight in with a positive mindset and you do the absolute best you can. Yeah. That is my advice to anyone at any career level as well, right? You also, you know, I have a mantra that's assume good, and you spoke about that when we talked about, you know, being deputy CEO, you know, assuming a good intent in the people around you, asking for help, but offering help, right? I think there's a couple of things in the formula I'm figuring out with you, I think, you know, that we can all take away, which I love.
Well,
but
the other thing for me is, if you don't like what you're doing, get out. I mean, it is so horrible when you hear people, I hate work. Well, you go there at least 40 hours a week, right? You're going to be miserable in your entire life if you don't love what you're doing.
Yeah, I love that. The conviction in the choice to say, I'm actually going to step off what is traditionally, you know, a path that a lot of people want and pursue something else, right? So anyway, we'll come up with the formula. It's forming. We'll get there. But great question. Thank you. I'm going to go to an online question, but I'm going to flip it because I can do that. And the question was, so you can answer both these questions. The question is, what advice would you give to your 20-year-old self? So you can answer that, but I'm gonna flip it a bit as well, because what I really wanna know is, what would your 20-year-old self say about you now? Because I think I know what you'd tell your 20-year-old self, but what would that person say about you?
Like, sometimes as you get older, you start to reflect on, how did I get here? You do, right?
Yeah.
Like, I don't think I'm naturally ambitious. See, people are laughing. I have our HR manager here. She'd probably laugh even harder.
No one believes you.
But I actually don't think I am competitive. I accept that. Like, I really liked winning the prizes at New South Wales Uni. Apart from the money, which was very helpful as well. I'm competitive, but I don't think I'm naturally ambitious. But what I am is a bit of a risk taker, to be honest, and it's what you said. Someone will go, there's this problem, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, well, that sounds really interesting. I'll have a go at that. And then realise I know nothing about it, but I'm going to figure it out. So I think having a bit of confidence that you're going to figure it out, you find the right people to help you figure it out, and you go on your journey. So I think I have taken risks.
Yeah.
Like, I remember when I said I was going to work in Prague, people looked at me like, what are you going to eat? Like, well, they have supermarkets in Prague. Yes. So that was a bit of a risk, but I think take risks, do different stuff, learn.
Phenomenal growth mindset.
And then, you know, make sure you've got those mentors that give you a bit of a kick when you need it.
Okay, so I am going to interrogate you a bit. They said earlier I wouldn't, but what would your 20-year-old self kind of look up and say? Like, would she be proud, surprised?
Oh, definitely.
All of them.
Probably going, what on earth? No, I didn't have a vision at 20 years old. I wanted to be financially secure. Yeah. I think she would be proud, actually.
Yeah, she should.
Not of me necessarily being a CEO, but I hope proud of the person
as a
human.
Yeah, I think that's important. That's why I like to flip the question, right? You want your 20-year-old...
But I wouldn't have done anything differently.
Good. That's why I don't ask the other question.
I would, like... No, a lot of people ask that question, you think back, maybe a couple of things, but nothing really. I'm eternally grateful that we didn't have mobile phones when I was growing up.
You and me both.
Or Instagram, or if it's...
Very good. Other questions in the audience? Okay, we've got a few, and one in front as well. So there's one question just there. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Justine. I'm currently in a graduate program working in a telecommunications company. So my question is, if there were 48 hours a day, how would you spend the extra 24 hours? Thank you.
That's probably not a good question for me, because my husband would say, at work. how would I, if there was another 24 hours? I'd probably try and improve my golf game, which I never get to do. I'd like to read more. I don't read enough just for pleasure, because I don't have much time. And I'd probably like to be a better friend to those people who still stick around, despite the fact that I come to dinners late, leave early, cancel at the last minute because work's really important or something's happening.
Great question.
It is a great question.
Yeah, very good. Now, another question in front.
Hi, it's Jen Dalitz. I'm an AGSM alumni. Alexis, they say it takes a lifetime to build a reputation and about a minute to destroy it. What advice would you have as the leader of AMP about what it takes to rebuild a reputation and trust as a leader?
Well, I think there's trust as a person and trust as an organisation. I mean, that is one of the biggest things we have been working on at AMP over the last years. And we would just spend an hour talking about this again today. I think it is about making promises that you intend to keep. There's times you can't always keep the promises, but certainly intent. Being consistent with what you're trying to do and with the way you're communicating, and being authentic. And I think, you know, when we make mistakes, and we always do, admitting those mistakes, owning up to them, and trying to do better going forward. But to the question, it is very easy to lose reputation. It is very, very hard to rebuild it, especially when you have an iconic brand and people do remember some of the bad things. I think as a person, though, it's really important to do that as well. And, you know, I talk to people who are leaving our organisation sometimes, and I think you always want to leave a place the way you came into a place. And I see some people leave in a blaze of not glory. This is a small world we live in, especially in Sydney and especially in business. And I can assure you, your reputation follows you wherever you go. And being conscious of that, conscious of the way you behave when you start, when you come to work, when you leave, is really, really important. And just being an authentic person to you.
Great answer. Wonderful question too. I know there was another question. Thank you. Just in the last row.
Thanks. My name is William, and I'm a tax consultant. My question to you is, what is your typical day? What does your typical day look like at AMP as a CEO? And say, if I were to switch job with you for one day, what are some of the things I will be most surprised at, or, you know, some of the things that I will feel, wow, that's a lot, if you know what I mean.
The first thing is, I'm never bored at AMP. So what does a typical day look like? Well, maybe we can start with today. So today we had our executive committee meeting. So that was, we have a year end of December. When you have a year end of December, our CFO rules court on how we can't spend any more money and we have to plan for the next year. So we have some robust discussions about the plan. Anyone who runs the business doesn't want to give up revenue. Anyone who's in the corporate functions needs more money. So we had 3 hours of debate about where we were going to grow, where we were going to be more efficient, how we were going to use AI, how much money we had to spend on our brand and reputation. So that was 3 hours of today. We are in the middle of doing some more branding and communication, so I wanted to speak to our communications people about how we were going to attach that. What would you be surprised at? Rarely get a lunch break. David said to me, why are you eating tonight? I'm like, because I haven't had any lunch today. I may look like I eat a lot, but you don't eat a lot during the day. So that's the first thing. And, you know, I usually go to two or three functions each week as well. So one day when I get to spend lots of time at home with my husband, I hope we're still going to be happily married because we don't spend a lot of time. But every day is really different. The one thing I do, and we have board the next 2 days, so that'll be a full-on 2 days of sitting in a room. The one thing I do try to do all the time in my diary is make sure I have one function every week with someone outside of AMP just to have a conversation about what's going on in the industry or what's a new IT or whatever. The other thing I try to do is make sure I do something about customer every single week because that's why we come to work. And then, you know, the third thing is always trying to learn something at least every week. But the thing you'd be surprised at is that my EA is the most powerful person in the organisation. And if she doesn't like you, you're not going to get to see me. And people who don't know that are very silly. But it's every organisation's the same.
Absolutely.
Fantastic. Okay, we have time for one last question. I saw your hand go up. Just here in front.
Thanks so much, Alexis. Thank you. I was really interested, I'm sure many people were, when you told us about the time you commit to Lifeline, which I applaud you for, which is wonderful. That commitment to helping others, what guidance would you give to us around the room when it comes to social impact and doing those, helping others? You told us about what it means to you, but what guidance would you have around social impact for us?
Look, people contribute. I've thought about this a lot, and I think David and I have had conversations about this many times as well. For me, it's important. It's not important for everyone, but for me, it is really important to give back. And I don't have the time to go and sit on a board, and I have a full-time job. I'm 100% committed to AMP. I can do my volunteer work on a weekend, and I'm happy to get up early on Saturday and go and do that. I personally think as leaders we do have a responsibility to support something that makes the world a better place. But I also do not judge people who don't want to do that because it's not a commitment everyone makes. I think it's important to leave this world better than we left it. We're not doing a great job at it at the moment. And for me, I think being willing to speak out on things that you're passionate about, things that you care about, are important, but we all do it in different ways, right? You have to do it what's comfortable for you. It doesn't mean using social media necessarily to hand your platform. And I did Lifeline for probably 5 or 6 years before. I never spoke about it because I thought it was something for me. And then I was talking to the people, some of the management in Lifeline, they said, could you please talk about it? Because we need more volunteers. Calls go unanswered. And we need more people there. And so that's why over the last couple of years I've talked about it a lot more because a lot of people just need a friendly voice at the end of the phone.
Lovely. Great last question, I think, to end on. Alexis, thank you so much. You know, when we came up, I said I felt privileged to have the opportunity. I now feel privileged, inspired, energized. I have a lot of formulas on leadership, personal leadership as well. Thank you so much for being so open and candid. I want to now invite Scott Perkins up to give the vote of thanks. So Scott is the managing partner at DTS Capital. He's also the advisory board chair of the University of New South Wales Business School Alumni Advisory Board. Sorry, it's a mouthful. Welcome, Scott.
Hi, everyone, and thanks so much, Alexis and Ellen. What a terrific last hour we've had. And I've taken what looks to be 3 pages of
incoherent notes here, so hopefully I'll be able to distill it down in a minute or two. But look, the real reason I and so many others love this event is because it's so personalised. And so I really want to thank you both for being so open, transparent and honest about your life, your career journey, your leadership aspirations and transition. And I think, you know, it's funny, just listening to you talk, it was almost like the two of you were just enjoying a meal at a restaurant rather than projecting to a few hundred people in the audience. So I really found that quite real, and I want to thank you both for that approach. Look, the big takeaway for me is how long and diversified one's career can be. And Alexis, you mentioned taking educated risks at the right time has been something that's been quite important to you. And this notion that, you know, your final work, not knowing what your final work destination is actually okay. And the fact that, you know, work is about the journey and the relationships you build along the way and being all in on whatever role you're doing at the time. I found that really quite profound, and I think really relevant to a lot of people in the audience here, because I think most people are probably closer to the start or the middle parts of their career rather than the end. So I found that particularly important. And to the point around embracing the journey, you know, going to the Czech Republic with the ING and not speaking the language and not necessarily knowing anyone or having any contacts there, I got the sense that was a really important part in your sort of career development. And look, maybe being the CEO of AMP is a snack compared to that.
No.
Maybe not. And look, finally, I just want to finish with, you know, I remain thrilled that you heeded the terrific advice of your mother to go to university, and particularly thrilled that you chose accounting and commerce at UNSW. And to hear you talk so fondly about this great institution is so profound for us in the room, because that is the one thing tonight that kind of binds us all together. So I really want to thank you for some of those comments. So thank you again for a great discussion. To acknowledge... To acknowledge our gratitude, a donation will be made to the UNSW Business School Educational Resource Access Scheme on your behalf. This scheme supports the inclusion and success of students from equity groups enrolled at UNSW Sydney in first year undergraduate business programs. I would like to thank our live stream audience, wherever you are, for your great questions tonight and indeed the questions coming from the audience. As mentioned earlier, this interview will be recorded and it'll appear on the UNSW Business School's YouTube channel and associated website. So this brings the Meet the CEO this evening to a close. For those of you that are here, please feel free to enjoy some drinks and company post this session. For those of you who have joined virtually or you need to dash, thank you for joining us. I hope you found the evening as valuable as I did. Thank you all for attending, and goodbye.